At the beginning of each year, we formulate a series of trends spanning categories like demographic, economic, generational, and technological that we think will shape the year ahead. As we have reached the middle of 2024, we thought that it would be worth taking a look back and check in on some of the trends and how these have played out. So joining me to do that today in this episode is McCrindle's Director of Strategy, Grant Dusting. Grant, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. It's always a pleasure to be on the Future Report podcast. So thanks for having me today.
Oh, my pleasure. It's always a delight to have you. I feel like you're such a wise, intentional thinker and communicator. And so I feel like you always bring a lot of value to our listeners, and you were the right person for this because you had a heavy hand at the beginning of this year in formulating and communicating some of the trends. And I was your idea just to even do this check-in on the trends, which I think is a really interesting thing to do. I found thinking about this episode and crafting the questions and the themes quite interesting, because we've been out and about sharing these things at conferences, and you know, we've done so much research even for our clients and off our own kind of thought leadership pieces that have just kind of added more depth and challenged us and reinforced in other aspects kind of the predictions that we had made. So the year's not over yet. So we've got another 6 months, but it's interesting to think about, yeah, where we've been, how we've lived, and how some of these trends have played out. So let's begin by looking at a trend that actually is taking us back even beyond the last 6 months. It's back to the beginning of 2023, which is recessionette. And it's a term that we coined to describe consumer sentiment being significantly impacted by a number of headwinds like global uncertainty and rising interest rates and the cost of living, leading to reduced spending. And I guess the more colloquial way I describe it is it's kind of like we're behaving like we're in a recession without actually being in one. And I've been at a few conferences where the term recession is thrown around. I was at one for the Property Council of Australia earlier this year with some pretty high up people at the various banks, and the term recession was being thrown around. And so I know that you're pretty attuned to this conversation as well, Grant. So looking at all that's happened so far in the last year and the last year, 2023, 2024, how do you think we're tracking with regards to this recessionette trend?
Yeah, well, I think, firstly, just on the point of the topic of this episode, like when you canvassed me on potential discussion points, I thought, yeah, it would be great to go back to some of the trends we've highlighted, because, you know, we're very thoughtful about the commentary we put out in the public domain, and the things that we say. We're not trying to be sensationalist. I think we hold ourselves back from doing things that way. So we have given these thought and thought, well, it'd be good to check in. And yeah, leading off with recessionette, I think it's something we highlighted in our trends of 2023. So in January last year. And yeah, I liked you reminded us the definition that we've come up with for this term that we've kind of made up ourselves, recessionette. And I really like, our colleague Steph reminded us at our recent team retreat that we're about data for people's sake. And I feel like this is a great example that, like, a recession does have a technical definition, which mostly economists could tell you. I mean, question without notice for you, Ash. Do you know how a recession is defined technically?
I know aspects, but I don't really want to butcher it in this public forum. So I'm just going to say no.
Yeah. Well, like I said, question without notice there, just to show our listeners this isn't fully scripted. And I think that's the case for most people. Like, most people, when they hear the word recession, they associate in their minds, oh, tougher economic times. But what does it actually mean? Well, economists will tell you that it's two quarters of negative economic growth. So kind of our economic output as a nation, our GDP, when that is negative or goes backwards for two quarters in a row. But for most people, they couldn't, if you walked up on the street to ask people, what does a recession mean? Most people couldn't tell you that. And I think, again, we're interested in data for people's sake. So for the average punter, the average citizen on the street, if it walks like a recession and it talks like a recession, then from the average person's perspective, well, that's what they're feeling and experiencing. So that's really what matters at the end of the day. So yeah, what we were getting at was 2023, whether we technically got into a recession, there's these forces that are conspiring to actually make life very difficult for people. And that's happening in Australia, but that's been happening across a lot of the developed world, since COVID. And I do have some numbers to share, and can feel pretty proud of this one, that we named this trend. There's lots of people talking about the negative kind of economic situation and just the outlook, but I think for us it's, again, not trying to be too technical about it, but saying, well, actually this is the feel of the people, and this is going to impact decisions, household decisions, business decisions too. So I've personally found the CommBank IQ cost of living report is a really helpful resource. So that is released a couple of times a year in Australia based on de-identified transaction data from around 7 million Australians. So it represents about 30% of Australians' total spend. And so between that data set and then the regular releases we get from the ABS, we can see that things like retail spending and consumer spending had a huge drop off in 2023. And that has continued into 2024. So recessionette, well, yeah, people are feeling the impact of rising cost of living, and they're making changes to their spending and to their lifestyle decisions accordingly. And and I think that's, we hear a lot about the headlines of that in the media, like cost of living. Was it the Macquarie Dictionary? Who had the word of the year, Cozy Lives?
Yeah.
So it's clearly, it's that phrase is something we hear a lot, the cost of living challenge or crisis, but what does that mean? So, I think recessionette, we have experienced that in the last 12 months, and we're not out of the woods yet. So there's a couple of thoughts on recessionette, but does that reflect your experience, Ash, and the people you're talking to?
Yeah, for sure. I think it's, like you mentioned, it does, as far as I'm aware, I don't think we have entered a technical recession, but even at that conference that I mentioned earlier, there was just so much talk about it and, if and when that happens, what are the implications? And yeah, there's just been so much airtime, I think, been given to the cost of living crisis. We hear it in every single daily news kind of program, and the implications. And like you mentioned, the data for human sake, wisdom from our colleague Steph, in terms of, it's interesting when we put out trends and insights, often that comes from research that we've done, whether that be us out conducting kind of brief in-depth interviews with people and just speaking to them at events and conferences when we're out and about, through to more of the scientific methodology of running surveys and focus groups. And even, when I'm at dinner parties, they're almost like little mini focus groups, and you kind of get a sense of what people are talking about. And I mean, as a millennial,
do you have your notepad with you, or just storing that?
Just the mental note. I mean, it's great to have the phone close by, just in case someone says something really profound, or exactly that you can make reference to on the podcast or in a presentation. But just, I think there is a lot of people talking about, the ways that they're saving money. I've shifted my behavior as a consumer as well, in terms of where we go grocery shopping and budget reallocations, and, people trying to be a bit more maybe frugal or just conscious. And so it definitely seems like, those insights we receive, like you mentioned, from CommBank or the ABS around consumer spend, does seem to be playing out in the lives of the people that I speak to, whether that's through formal research or more anecdotal. It'll be interesting to see as the trends continue, as we continue to see how the Reserve Bank continues to position interest rates and things like that, what kind of flow and effects that has, because we also see it, like you mentioned, in different contexts, in a consumer context, at an individual context, even with businesses that we work with at an organizational level. It has some big flow-on effects, this recessionette kind of mindset or attitude. So,
yep.
Yeah, be interesting.
And you mentioned frugality there. Do you want some? I've got some interesting numbers that I think are quite interesting on actual the cutbacks to spending and who's doing that.
Yeah, would love to hear it.
Well, I think it just highlights something we try to do through our research, that society's not homogenous. And we all know that if we take just a moment to pause and reflect on that. But I think sometimes that can, the diversity of society can get lost in some of these big policy discussions around, you know, inflation went up by this much and average wages went up by this much and housing costs is this much. But there's a spectrum of where people are at in their income and wealth and economic status. So yeah. Another thing I really appreciate about the CommBank IQ data is they split it by age group as well. And even bringing our generational lens, this totally checks out with what I've been hearing, that in the last year or so, the age group that has most reduced their spending have been older Gen Zs and younger Gen Ys. So that's basically from 25 to like late 30s. This cohort of Australians have reduced their spending the most in the last 18 months. And so by that, we can see that they're really feeling the impact of the cost of living the most acutely. Like, and this is using transaction data as well. So, for example, 25 to 29-year-olds. So we haven't seen it for younger Gen Zs, and that's probably because a lot of those people in their early 20s are still living at home, so sheltered from you know, some of those costs of housing and paying the bills and paying a mortgage and those things. But even in the 25 to 29-year-old age bracket, in the last year, leading up to November 2023, so basically in the 2023 calendar year, 25 to 29-year-olds reduced their discretionary spending by 6.2%. And basically, over 65s increased their discretionary spending by about the same amount, about 6%. We can kind of say, on the whole, this is the case for society, that, you know, average spending has gone up or down by this much, but actually there's nuances within that. So I think the story is that, yeah, those who are either trying to save for a house, people who are renting, or people who've recently entered the housing market and have a massive mortgage, they're the ones feeling the crunch the most with all of those interest rate rises we've seen. Whereas those who are in the position of having, you know, worked hard for many years and, you know, paid off a mortgage or living relatively debt-free, they've benefited from the house price and asset price growth and have, you know, assets and an income that's doing well. So the data shows that they're spending. And actually the biggest increase in spend for the over 65s was around, it was in travel. So again, I think recovering from the couple of COVID years and saying, well, actually, yeah, treat myself, whether it's a cruise or a holiday, that's kind of been something that's jumped out. And for the younger generations, the biggest cutbacks have been on household goods, apparel, like clothing, and retail. So, yeah, interesting that apparel features, because I think we're also hearing a lot about the circular economy and like thrifting and younger consumers being both, you know, it's fashionable to thrift, and like from a fashion perspective, that's a lot more acceptable or even desirable. But I think economically as well, it's a lot of people going, well, that makes sense, rather than forking out a lot on big ticket kind of clothing items. So yeah, are you surprised to hear some of those cutbacks, or how does that fit with what you're seeing?
Yeah, I think it's very similar to what I have seen and would have expected, and it links to a couple of other trends. We had the grandparent economy as one that I know you and I have talked about a little bit off mic in terms of, yeah, that kind of the baby boomer cohort or 65 plus demographic who have in some ways benefited, like you said, from their really hard work, but also from the recent economic times that are kind of hitting those of us without assets or without long-term investments.
Yes, and it's true to say those of us, because both of us are in that, you know, Gen Y,
yeah.
You know, younger Gen Y cohort.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, and, you know, again, it's interesting when you see insights from research played out in your own life. Like, it's almost like case studies, you know, about when I think about my friends and what we're talking about compared to, you know, my parents' generation and what they're talking about and the different kind of qualms we all have around finances and savings and wealth accumulation. But it's also interesting, like you mentioned, around younger generations paring back their spend and that circular economy, which was another trend we talked about, I think, a couple of years ago, which I've definitely seen as well. And almost like the rise of like secondhand fashion and the more acceptability and accessibility, yeah, with regards to that. And it's interesting. It's like, what's driving that? Is it fashion trend? Is it an economic driver behind that, or is it just made it kind of exacerbated or excelled a trend that we're already seeing? So it's interesting to see, for me, I'm sure for you as well, how these different what we call mega trends, so like economics, demographics, technology, generation, how they kind of interplay with one another rather than just looking at one trend by itself. So it's fascinating.
Yeah, and I think that is a reason we pick the trends we do, like recession, it, because within that there's, you know, we can talk about all these different aspects within that one kind of mega trend.
Yeah, for sure. And you mentioned, I guess, some of the implications even from recession ed or some links to housing and just how we look after a growing population, how we house everyone, how does everyone have access to safe housing is one part of that, but also then the affordability of said housing. Which I think kind of all links to the growth reckoning trend that we talked about, which has got some complexities and nuance to it in terms of, you know, you've got the population growth factor that we've rebounded in light of the closed border years of the pandemic. We've kind of come back with quite a force with regards to population growth and net overseas migration. But of course, then with that comes discussions of the implications of that, particularly housing supply and demand. It's been a hot topic these last few months, but I feel like it's always a hot topic just in general. What are your reflections on this trend, Grant, and how it's kind of played out so far in 2024?
Yeah, well, housing has definitely been one of the key public discussion topics of the year, it seems, in politics in Australia and policies and governments trying to grapple with, well, how do we respond to this? And I mean, that's one symptom of what we were trying to highlight with this trend, the growth reckoning. And we use that word reckoning because we feel that, well, you know, Australia's population has been growing very strongly post-COVID, and in the last reporting year in 2023 grew by a record 650,000 people. So to put that in context, that's more than the population of Canberra and Darwin combined. So Australia added Canberra plus Darwin last year alone, and just to put that in perspective. So it's very high growth by, or it's the most people we've ever grown by in a year, because the population, you know, the base increases each year, but even as a percentage, 2.5%, that's really high by historical standards. So, and we know that most of that growth, and we highlighted this in our Trends of the Year event, most of that growth is coming through net overseas migration. We know historically it's been, or at least in the last 20 years or so, the long run average has been around 60-40 in terms of 60% of our population growth from migration and then 40% from natural increase. Births. So 60-40 is the long run average, but in the last year to 2 years, it's been more like 85-15, I think 84% from net migration in the most recent reporting period. So, I think the population continues to grow, and governments, state, federal and local, really it's incumbent upon them to respond and to reckon with it. And we need to make decisions about what we prioritize, because we can't, you can't just keep adding people and expect that everything else can stay the same. Because growth impacts infrastructure, housing affordability, traffic congestion, demand for essential services like health and education. And then you got the social cohesion side. So what have we seen? Well, we have seen it this year already, the current federal government has already tightened, I think actually this was late last year, they tightened international student visa entry settings. So basically making it, and I think they did this by increasing the English language proficiency level required to get an international student visa. So getting a bit technical there, but I'm hearing that that's already having an impact in reducing, well, not reducing, but yeah, in relative terms, reducing the number of international students compared to what it would have been had that setting not changed. So they definitely tightened down on some of the visa criteria to try to reduce migration a little. Where the federal opposition has made it a kind of a plank of their policy to reduce permanent migration. So you know they've come and put that out there and. In their budget reply speech, which was in May, it's a couple of months ago. So, yeah, we can see that the federal government is looking at ways to respond, but really a lot of it comes down to housing affordability is the key symptom at the moment of, just the sustained population growth. So the governments can't keep up with the demand, and it's unsustainable for us to keep just urban sprawling further and further out. I mean, I live in Perth, which is one of the most, you know, sprawled capital cities in the world. Like when you consider our population is only around 2.5 million, that's, you know, the length of Perth metro area in terms of kilometres is, it's right up there. And that's, I think that's typical of the Australian way of, you know, having large homes, large blocks. That's kind of been the traditional Australian way, but that's, government's looking at, well, we can't sustain that. And so there's been discussions around incentivizing people to downsize, and I don't think we've really seen much traction on that topic yet, but I'd be watching that space. I saw this really interesting report last month around the spare bedrooms in Australia. It's a bit hard to piece together. I think on the ABS data or from the census data, I think it's around 3.5 million spare bedrooms, but there's debates about how best to measure that and how accurate the different metrics are. So this study for WA I saw actually used water, like utility, like water meter readings, to kind of gauge a home's empty or not, because obviously if you're living there you need to use running water. And so they had some calculations on how they did that, and they estimate 1.4 million spare bedrooms in Western Australia alone, and that's accounting for, and so that will include like a storage room, that's a bedroom that's been used as storage. But it kind of kicked off a bit of a discussion about, well, what would happen if more of those spare rooms were actually being used to house people, as a solution. So that's a discussion that's happening. I know in New South Wales particularly there's been a lot of discussion around social housing investment required, and there's advocacy being done in that space. I think that's really trying to house our most vulnerable. So I think that's a very worthy kind of policy discussion. So yeah, it seems to be, in terms of the growth reckoning, you've got all the infrastructure and traffic congestion things, which will continue, you know, new public transport investment required. But it seems to be housing affordability is the nut that the governments are trying to crack at the moment. So I suppose we'll wait and see if any kind of policies are announced that make a difference. Because even the big kind of home building, policy announced by the federal government of ambitions to create this many new homes, when we compare that with the current population growth trajectory, it's not even really going to keep up with the growth. So they're ambitious targets by kind of historical standards, but even those are really not going to be sufficient.
Yeah, it's a really interesting one. There are so many different kind of layers, and your point, I think, even about like the Aussie psyche and how we view living and home ownership. And like, I've spoken to a few people this year even about the concept of build to rent, and just even like every time we run a study about home ownership, like the dream about owning your own home as the top goal for Gen Z just comes out every year, even though the climate's tough, it's still there. And even though it's tough, it's still like ingrained. And we did another research piece a couple of months ago, and it was interesting to see that for those looking to buy their first property, they're most likely to want a freestanding home, which was 65%, followed by an apartment, 22%, land, 7%, and semi-detached house, 2%. And then of current owners looking to buy an additional property, 62% still opting for the freestanding home. And so it's just so many of us are like, yep, detached home with a backyard, that's the way to go. And it's really interesting even what you said about the spare rooms. Like, that's a really interesting way to think about not wasted space, but how many people are living in bigger homes than they need. It's interesting.
Yeah. Well, I think everyone, there's broad agreement that we need to increase the supply of housing, but the challenge is how do you do that? Because, you know, we've got a shortage of some of those key trades, you know, bricklayers and builders and the like. So those don't just grow on trees. And then if you bring them in from overseas through skilled migration, then you're kind of adding to the just challenge of population growth. So yes, it's one that policymakers, I think, really need to reckon with, but that's going to be important for us as a nation going forwards.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an interesting one. And like you said, a few conundrums that come with that people are trying to fix and trying to crack. Another one that we kind of talked about earlier this year was something we called superiority, which is another in McCrindle fashion phrase that we have coined, which describes the perceived superiority and productivity when people make the effort to come into the office in this kind of work from home era. So I feel like we all know that we're in a work from home era. And with this trend, we, I guess, wanted to look at maybe a bit more of the subtlety or the nuance or how that's going to play out. And it's been interesting to see, I think, just more and more conversations about, I guess, bigger companies trying to bring staff back, but being met with some resistance even around if they've been working remotely for a couple of years now for multiple days a week and that's become the new normal. How do you bring people back? But then the other side of it is there is this desire for people to want to come back because work is so much more than just an exchange for your time and talents. It's community, it's connection. Even there's some merit in separating work and home and having boundaries and mental health and benefits. So there's lots of different kind of ways to look at it. But what are your reflections on the superiority trend so far?
I loved the term and the play on words, you know, of superiority there. But and I think it does reflect both a perceived superiority of people in the office. And I was just looking up some of the stats that we highlighted in our Trends of 2024 event. From our national study, we found that 57% of hybrid workers who take a video call from home indicated they're worried they're missing out on some discussion after a call ends. And 7 in 10 Aussie workers said they feel that working in the workplace leads to a greater sense of recognition and appreciation of their efforts rather than working from home. So we kind of highlighted the employee perspective that there's a perception there that actually I'm missing out. Yeah, just it's FOMO, but in a work context, I'm missing out on interactions and I'm missing out on kind of particularly my bosses and managers kind of seeing me working and that interaction. I think the pendulum swung pretty quickly through COVID, didn't it? Where overnight, seemingly, at least, all kind of office-based workers and anyone who could feasibly work from home was more or less, you know, asked to do that. And some companies went really hard on that and said, you know, this is our new policy, new normal, you know, sold their office space, etc. And I think fair to say the pendulum has swung back probably to a bit more of an equilibrium. But what we are seeing is that the flexibility genie is out of the bottle, if you like. And there is that. So in terms of flexibility, I don't think we're going back. And even the discussions that I've been hearing recently with leaders of, you know, some of these larger businesses around their kind of work policies, a lot of them do seem to have settled on some kind of policy of, you know, around 3 days in the office and then a couple of days flexible. It seems to be the most common. So there does seem to be recognition that the new normal is to provide flexibility. And the only question that companies are working through is, what does that look like and how is that delivered? And as you've highlighted, the younger generation of workers, particularly Gen Z, at the start of their working careers, they're the ones who actually are most, they're keen for flexibility, but they're actually even more keen to be growing and learning and socializing. And that's a lot harder to do when you're remote. So we've kind of got those two kind of influences or trends working in tension there. And I think we found that with our own team as well, you could say, that we do have, yeah, a lot of Gen Zs and Gen Ys in our McCrindle team. And I think there is, we have seen that desire for flexibility, but also that desire for team culture and to feel that sense of connection and collaboration, which you have a lot, you have to work a lot harder to get the same sense of that when you're remote or kind of virtual.
Yeah, and I think the complexities around this particular trend and the different tensions and themes does make it a bit of a tough situation for workplace leaders to try and accommodate the flexibility but also invest in the culture and build that because you want to accommodate for different people's preferences and life stages and lifestyles. But you also need to make it fair for everyone. But then there's also an expectation that there's a workplace culture that is being invested into and intentionally kind of being built. And I just, yeah, it just seems like it was easier when everyone kind of was on a similar way of working pre-pandemic. But yeah, we see it in our own team as well. And I guess, yeah, some people, even I speak to in my own life who are more remote, I think probably do feel this superior officy where they do have that FOMO, and that's so understandable. And sometimes I get it when I'm out traveling on the road and you're all of a sudden thrown into the person being on the screen and the majority are in the room and you're like, oh, it's not the same. So it's there's pros and cons to each, as there always is. So,
and I think it's incumbent on leaders then, workplace leaders, to recognize that does exist, that it is a thing, those not in the room, how can you include them better, whether they're working from home or whether they're just working remotely, kind of permanently in like a satellite office or separate to the main group or the main kind of physical room, to use that phrase. So I think that's the challenge for the modern leader, is how do you provide and ensure that inclusion and that sense of equity when you're also trying to cater for differences and provide flexibility.
Yeah, absolutely. And it actually does link quite well even to the final trend we wanted to touch on, which is one we described as community redefined, which I guess comes from the basis that many people in our research, and notably younger generations, say they feel more socially isolated than before and then previous generations. So you've got this kind of trend, and it makes sense even with superior officy and flexibility, where so much of our work and lives can be done away from others, even though we tend to thrive when we're in community with other people as human beings. And I guess then you've got more of our lives just lived online with social media. And so you've got new ways of people meeting the timeless need for human connection. But whether that those are all equal ways or not is an interesting one up for debate and discussion. any reflections from you, Grant, on how you've seen this trend play out so far this year?
Yeah, community redefined. So, again, I think a reason we liked this and selected this as one of our trends of the year is that there's several threads to it, and you know, it incorporates the digital world and the world of social media and the way that people are interacting with and using social media and how that's changing. There's the interesting thing that we saw through COVID of, as people were working more in a more distributed way, or i.e. like remote or from home or hybrid, that we did see a return to local and people prioritizing their local sense of place and community, their local coffee shop, their local park, those kind of things. So that was something we observed and thought, it'll be interesting to see how this continues and if it does. And then just the high levels of loneliness and social anxiety that we see. And last year, Australia had its first ever Loneliness Awareness Week, which is in August. So depending on when people are listening to this podcast, may even be this week. So there's a few threads there. And I think it's been interesting. Like, I've seen a lot of discussion, you know, this year so far around, there's a new book released recently by, called The Anxious Generation by a guy named Jonathan Haidt, you know, New York Times kind of best-selling author vibes. If people haven't come across this book, it's really talking about youth mental health and the impacts of social media and screen time. And like, one of the discussions I've been following with interest that relates to this sense of community and digital devices is in schools, and actually what's a school's policy on mobile phone use in school. Mm-hmm. We've had some jurisdictions ban phones in schools kind of unilaterally, and some leave it up to the individual schools to decide. So I think that just highlights that those who are working with our youngest generations are trying to grapple with how do we, like, the challenge is focus, but it's also a social one of like human connection, and how can we equip, well, our youngest who we're forming, who are still being formed, how can we equip them with kind of the guardrails and skills to navigate the modern world, rather than developing habits that their parents might have, or grandparents, but actually developing those habits at such a young age and thinking, what's the impact of that going to be on their long-term kind of mental health and well-being? So, you know, a lot of studies have shown similar things, and our own stats were 59% of Australians say they feel lonely often or sometimes. Gen Z is even much higher. 71% of Gen Z say they feel lonely often or sometimes. So it's, it's a huge social challenge. And I think, probably what I've been hearing most in terms of this topic has been around, mobile phone use in schools and how schools are, their policies, but also then how they're supporting students to use technology and digital devices in a healthy way that can kind of encourage human connection. I think a lot of people are feeling like digital fatigue. I feel like it's a huge thing, and particularly the younger generations too, the basically Gen Z and Gen Y, I think particularly, just overwhelmed with, like, there's so many communication platforms today, either phone-based or kind of web computer-based, and people have to be very intentional about trying to set good boundaries. So I think that seems to be a big talking point at the moment. And then the impacts on people's, you know, mental health from that too. So, I mean, bring back the dinner parties, I say. Like, do that, you know, you referenced before going out to dinner with friends, and I think, or having them over, because, you know, cozy lives crisis. So, you know, I think there are things we can do socially to kind of help address some of these challenges of social isolation and disconnection. Like I know for us personally, yeah, it's been getting to know our neighbours and trying to foster community that way, like our physical neighbours in our street, has been a lot of fun. And a small thing we've done, but something that's really blessed us and people have really enjoyed too.
Yeah, it's an interesting one because I feel like this one has like all of them, which is why, as you've mentioned a couple of times, why we've chosen these ones is because they are layered and they're interesting to talk about and think about with different lenses on. And I think with the community redefined one, it's interesting because part of it was like we talked about even like the rise of micro communities and using technology to connect, and like it can be really good for that, but in the same breath it can also be overwhelming. And like I remember a study we did, I think it was 2021 with Gen Z. I was only talking about it to a school early this week, about it was like a majority of Gen Z know that like social media can have a negative impact on their mental health, but it's like 74% don't want to go off it because they're scared that they'll miss out on what's going on. And I had the exact same situation the other day. Like I had a group chat of friends and we were organizing a dinner party, and one of them almost missed out on coming, and I just figured that she couldn't make it. But she was like, no, I was trying to get off social media and have some balance. Mm. But in doing that, she missed the social gathering that we were trying to plan in real life. So it's interesting to see like how it can be used for good and help us to connect, but also how we still rely on it so much to communicate. And yeah, there's so many group chats and it can be overwhelming and it can be easy. And I know even for younger people, some other people in my life, they'll just, you know, you can see on WhatsApp if people have read anything, and sometimes the messages like leave you on read, or the phrases leave you on read, and can seem a bit rude, but sometimes it's just out of self-preservation to have some kind of distance and space from it all. So it's an interesting kind of multifaceted trend around how we connect, how we engage and participate in community. So.
Yeah, and I think for us picking this one, Community Redefined, we weren't saying that community is going to be redefined and finalized in 2024. Like it's an ongoing discussion, yeah, obviously, but I think, yeah, even from what we've discussed there's a lot of things that have been, yeah, happening this year and discussions that are happening in society, which kind of, feed into this broader discussion on how are we connecting as human beings and how is that going to be changing, and what are some things we can do to try to maintain and foster that human connection.
Yeah, for sure. It's been a fantastic conversation, Grant, as always. Thank you so much for your time and your insights and for coming on the podcast today.
It is truly my pleasure. Thanks.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you for listening and bye for now.